in college, you have the spectrum of like, the parents are super supportive, and then there are the parents who are like, hey, maybe you should be a doctor. I would say to parents is, don't just shut them down and be like, okay, you should probably have a backup plan. You should go like full steam ahead and support their dreams.
I guess you could say it wasn't made for that kind of use.
Oh my gosh.
What is the primary difference between working at a smaller sort of company, maybe more of a boutique one, versus like a big company like DreamWorks?
For DreamWorks, it's really cool. They pass the camera down, like your camera, down the line in pipeline. So then the animators will get your camera and your face and other characters.
You have to put in the time and grind it out. It's almost like being an entrepreneur starting a business, but once you get there, it's a dream job.
We realized she couldn't fit into the vacuum very well. Like, it wouldn't be as believable.
Because the dust buddies are totally believable.
I know, like, they can hold the Ritz cracker, it's all good. Like, cartoon logic.
Being an artist and a creative person comes down to being very resourceful as well.
Starting off, your pay is pretty low, and you have to go with, like, you know, a bunch of roommates and like, try to make it out here in LA and slowly work your way up and get the pay that you think you deserve.
What's good, everybody? Welcome to Mad Artist Publishing, the place to be for short films, VFX and animated shorts, and interviews with directors and animators that create them. I'm your host, Marcin, and today we're going to be talking to and interviewing Elizabeth Tomashek. Elizabeth is a graduate from the Ringling School of Art and Design, where she studied animation. She is a talented animator, illustrator, and a Previs artist. She has animated and sketched for the Hasbro Toy Company, has worked on films such as Thor, Ragnarok, Spider-Man Homecoming. Currently, she is the Previs and layout artist at DreamWorks Animation Studios in Los Angeles. In addition, she has found the time to illustrate a children's book called Up Up the Triceratops by Mitchell Martin. I hope you get royalties from that in some way.
A little bit.
Yeah, okay.
Because a lot of artists get stuck with just doing the commission, right?
Yeah, that was actually like part of the deal. He asked up front, like, hey, do you want royalties, or do you want just a full thing? I'm like, yeah, I'll take the royalties.
You're not just an animator, you're a business person. Elizabeth is also the co-creator and director of the viral short film Dust Buddies that has amassed a whopping 6.6 million views on our YouTube channel. Today we're going to chat about her journey on becoming an animator, her schooling experience, some of her career highlights, and she's also give us some advice on what it takes to be in this industry. In addition, we're going to watch Dust Buddies and get her reaction to some of the comments that you guys made on her film.
It's soft and I can touch them. You're going to get poisoned, just touch dust. You may get COVID-19.
Oh my god.
And how come this guy's so evil looking? This is so, Napoleon, right?
Yeah, that's Napoleon.
I guess you could say it wasn't made for that kind of use.
Oh my gosh. I think if this was redone in like a feature film sense, or like a short film at like DreamWorks or Disney or anything.
Yeah.
I want to do that.
So make sure you guys tune in for the full video. Elizabeth, thank you for joining me. Welcome. And congratulations on all your success.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
So before we dive in and we talk about the Dust Buddies, tell us about yourself. Were you always an artist growing up?
Yes, definitely. My family, I come from a family of artists, actually. My grandpa is a sculptor. And my uncles do a lot of like oil painting. And my one uncle does wood carving. So it's been in the family and kind of influenced me to, you know, go with my passion and go for my love of art and drawing and animations.
Well, that's going to shift my questions entirely. Most parents still don't necessarily support the creative people out there. My parents were like, how are you going to make a living? What do you tell parents out there who are worried about their kids getting into this creative industry?
Well, it's interesting. Like in college, you have the spectrum of like, the parents are super supportive. And then there are the parents who are like, hey, maybe you should be a doctor. And then, you know, there's all the in between. But I would say to parents is, you know, encourage them. Like when you see like that they're into animation, they're into art, don't just shut them down and be like, okay, you should probably have a backup plan. You should go like full steam ahead and support their dreams first off. And then once you wrap your mind around that, you need to help them with like looking for pre-college programs, which I think is a huge benefit to any high school student. That's actually what I did. My mom was like, she found the Ringling pre-college program. It was probably the best thing I did, you know, during high school to try to learn about animation, because it was always just, you know, a fun pastime. But I think parents need to research like different ways of benefiting their kid as far as like getting into the animation industry. So
the creative industry right now is one of the most stable industries out there. There's so many opportunities out there for illustrators, animators, and VFX artists. The amount of money that you get paid is staggering, you know, as long as you stick with it. But we both know, because I was in the animation as well, and I, you know, it's like you have to put in the time and grind it out. It's almost like being an entrepreneur starting a business, but once you get there, it's a dream job. Why did you choose, drawing and animation versus sculpting and wood carving?
Well, I do wood carving on the side. So my uncle's, you know, trying to teach me how to do that. So that's my hobby, but my love of animation developed when I was a kid. My parents would always put on like Disney or DreamWorks, like animated films, and I would just be glued to the TV. Like trying to figure out like, oh my God, that's a drawing moving. Like, how did they do that? Like I didn't watch any of the documentaries. I was just, you know, staring at the TV trying to figure it out. That's where the love of animation kind of came from. And maybe it became an obsession and like just grew into like, okay, I need to make that. I need to do flip books. I need to do like, you know, all the extra things to try to make my own animation.
What is the best and worst thing about being in this industry?
Best thing I would say are the people. My coworkers are so creative and so driven, and that kind of fuels me to, you know, be more creative, like figure out new ways of working the camera or the characters. But yeah, definitely the people and just the environment being around them is very, very fun and fulfilling. But I have to say, like we were talking about the grind, like the worst thing is starting off, your pay is pretty low and you have to go with like, you know, a bunch of roommates and like try to make it out here in LA and or wherever you're at. You just have to slowly work your way up and get the pay that you think you deserve and that you're worth. So it's definitely like, you know, a process. But I think that's kind of like the worst thing about it for me.
Can you give us a Cole's Notes or a quick summary of sort of what you do at DreamWorks, for example, as a Previs layout artist?
So as a layout artist, we usually go into the meeting, get launched on a sequence. We see the storyboards for that sequence and then go back to my desk and kind of just digest what that whole sequence entails. Like what kind of camera should I be using? What is the action? What is it trying to say? And then I'll start blocking it. So I'll start blocking the characters, the camera, and then once that's done, I'll start finessing the camera and like adding the shake and all that, and then adding the effects into it. So we usually use cards or like if there's an explosion, like rubble, animated rubble and geo. So that's kind of, and then you light it and then it's done and then you redo it. So it's kind of like.
Yeah. Well, how would you explain Previs?
It looks like a 2005 video game, but the bones are there for the action.
It's kind of like a very simple basic animation cartoon that looks nothing like the final result, right?
Yes, and for DreamWorks it's really cool, they pass the camera down, like your camera down the line in pipeline, so then the animators will get your camera and your placement of the characters, so it, you know, 3D space.
What animators or artists do you admire most?
Well, my supervisor from third floor, Jim Baker, he is insanely talented with the camera, and he was actually a Disney animator years back, so he's really helped mentor me and kind of show me like what lenses to use and what you need to do to develop a sequence. Patrick Haskew from third floor, he was a Ringling alumni that kind of mentored me and helped me out at third floor when I was just starting up and gave me advice about the work industry, plus his work like modeling and texturing really helped me grow in that area. Heidi Jo Gilbert, who's an insanely talented storyboard artist. So I would receive her storyboards usually. I'm like, I'm just blown away by how beautiful they are. It could be a 2D animated film. But yeah, she's super talented and inspiring. And then like a bunch of this dev artists like Zach Retz is like, oh man, he draws like lunch sketches every day. Very inspiring to me. But
what three websites do you visit for inspiration?
Cinematic paintings. This one would help out anybody who's interested in cinematography, composition, layout. And this website is super helpful. There's different tabs up top with like medium shot, close-up, upshot, and their keyframes of films. I love this website so much as far as reference of like, oh my God, look at that composition. I wanna do something like that. Or go back and draw it and just, you know, help hone my skills in drawing and painting. So that one is great for cinematography. I usually go back to, I know this is basic, but Pinterest to try to
hey, Pinterest is great.
There's so much, like if I'm referencing like a certain type of lighting and I need, you know, two-tone lighting or 3-point lighting, then I'll reference it there.
I find that being an artist and a creative person comes down to being very resourceful as well, because a lot of the time, you know, you will be stuck on a project, and yes, you have the ability to talk to your colleagues, but sometimes at the end of the day, you know, you want to infuse yourself into the project, so you're gonna force yourself, you know, to get out there and get your own stuff, so you can be proud of it when you see it on the big screen, right?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, this is like a broad thing, but I definitely think researching for like layout would be on YouTube. What I do mainly is I love to watch the Vanity Fair breakdowns of a scene. And I recently watched a Westworld breakdown where Lisa Joy, I think she directed like a season 2 episode, and she broke down everything, like camera moves and why she did what she did. And any of those videos, I absolutely love. Like anytime a cinematographer breaks down, you know, what they did, like Roger Deakins, it's amazing to see why they chose that instead of going a different route, you know, the lighting, the cameras, the lenses. So yeah, I find YouTube to be a great resource. And just looking up like even clips of movies and studying them.
Talking about movies, what are some of your favorites?
Oh my gosh, I have quite a few, but my main favorite is Short Term 12.
Short Term 12?
Yeah, it's a very, oh man, I love it so much. It's an indie movie. This is more of just like a story, like why I love it. Like camera work, it's fine. It's like a handheld sort of documentary kind of feel. But the acting is amazing.
Shit, I didn't see this one.
It was just like a small little indie.
But those are the best. I don't know if you've seen, there's this movie called The Platform that came out on Netflix. That's pretty good.
Another one would be Scott Pilgrim versus the World. I love Edgar Wright. So basically any of his movies are kind of my favorites, like Hot Fuzz, which we actually parodied for our Dust Buddies poster. I love TV right now. I think TV is in its golden age as far as like cinematography and camera work. I absolutely love Westworld. As far as camera, location, you know, their compositions are beautiful. And I also love the camera work in Euphoria. Story's okay, but the camera work in a couple of scenes were amazing, the way they shot it.
You work at DreamWorks like crazy. Do you remember how you felt when you actually got offered the job?
I was stunned. I think I thought it was a joke at first. I'm like, are you serious? Like, just pranking me or something? But I was definitely like shocked by it. Yeah, I got the call actually on the Disney lot, which was kind of weird. I'm like, oh god! But they called me and were like, hey, here's the offer. Yes.
Did you get a credit in Thor and Spider-Man?
I didn't get credit in Thor. I worked on that for 2 weeks, and I think you had to be working over 2 weeks. So if I worked like a couple more hours, I would have gotten credit.
Okay.
So I worked on Ant-Man. I actually went to Georgia, Atlanta, and Atlanta, Georgia, and then we did Previs there, like on the lot, on the studio lot. And
you obviously watched the movie, and you wait for your credit. What does that feel like?
Yeah, when I first saw it for Spider-Man Homecoming, it was kind of surreal. Like, did they put it in there? Did they spell my last name wrong? I don't know. But yeah, it was an amazing feeling. So that was, you know, what I was working towards basically my whole career. But it's just cool to see that, you know, scroll past. Like Dust Buddies, it was cool. Like, oh, there it is. But an actual movie, it's really cool.
Yeah, now you just got to keep working your way higher and higher on the credit list.
Yes, right.
What is the primary difference between working at a smaller sort of company, I'm going to be more of a boutique one, versus like a big company like DreamWorks?
I think the main thing would be the tech support. Like tech support at DreamWorks is really, I mean, they've done an amazing job. Like their pipeline is very fluid. At smaller studios, you sort of have to kind of figure it out yourself sometimes. And that's a little bit more difficult for people. The job is very cushy because it's like, here's the support for this, here's free food, here's all this, like all these benefits. So overall, like the tech support has been like the biggest step up.
Do you find that at smaller agents, you're sort of like a jack of all trades almost?
Like, at Third Floor, it was interesting because it's more of a generalist thing, like do it all, you know, like try to add the effects, lighting, like you're literally doing the whole process in one shot. But at DreamWorks, I have to say the layout department is more of like a jack of all trades, just as a job. Like I think across the industry, you have to be a generalist because each shot, like at DreamWorks, they do more of a previs instead of like a layout thing, like I think Disney and other companies do, where you add the effects, you add the lighting, and sometimes you even spline the animation, which you make it more fluid instead of the choppy step to animation.
What software do you use at DreamWorks Animation Studio?
We use Maya primarily, and then Nuke and Photoshop. So it's kind of basic. A working knowledge of Linux helps a lot.
Nice.
Yeah. So, but it's pretty simple to learn once you get the hang of it.
Well, many of the viewers that are watching these videos, you know, dream of working at big studios. Can you offer any tips on what they can do now to increase their chances of being hired at these prestigious studios?
I would say for any like high school students, definitely check out any pre-college programs.
What is a pre-college program? It's like an internship almost?
It's more of like just classes during the summer. So I got to pick, I actually took sculpting and 2D animation during that time.
And those are offered by who? The studio?
So I took this when I was a junior in high school. So you take these classes and they count as credits towards like college credits, which is great. So you're not just, you know, throwing money at like a camp or something like that. So
Did you consider any other schools besides Ringling?
I considered SCAD. I was really tempted because they have athletics and I have loved to, you know, been on the soccer team or done like some other extracurricular activities. I was on the Quidditch team at Ringling.
So you don't know why? What?
The Quidditch team.
A Quidditch? What is a Quidditch?
Quidditch, you know, the Harry Potter. But yeah, so that was their only sport. So I'm like, I'm going to do it. I'm going to be a beater.
Okay. If you have to go back where you were starting out and you could talk to a young version of yourself, what advice would you give yourself now, knowing what you know about Ringling school and the industry?
Well, I would say to myself, hey, Beth, don't do fur on your thesis. Don't do it. Just do something else. But besides that, I would say you should draw more. Yeah, I wish I started that sooner, that habit of trying to draw a little bit each day just to get better. And especially drawing like human faces, which I find are the most difficult things to draw. Start there and keep drawing.
Let's talk about your time at Ringling School of Art and Design. Why did you choose this school? And can you briefly describe the curriculum?
I chose Ringling mainly because I went to the pre-college program and saw how intense it was, and just the environment too. It's just such a creative atmosphere, and everybody there was just so into art, which was such a great thing for me. So, you know, I developed friendships there too, and I really loved the way Ringling Films turned out as well. And that was a big push for me. So I'm like, okay, I saw a Defective Detective, and that was the films that really, I don't know, stood out to me. Like, oh my gosh, look at that quality. Look at the story. The story can hold up. And yeah, like, I want to make something like that. So I felt like the level was a little bit different, and I wanted to go to Ringling based on the quality of their films.
And the curriculum?
Freshman year, you learn basically the fundamentals, like drawing, shading, all that. And so both semesters, you're doing more of like the building blocks of what animation is, like figure drawing and movement and stuff like that. And then sophomore year, you get into Maya. And that's when you, you know, your life is taken up by the labs and you do 2D animation, which is great. So you're still using that drawing that you were honing in on freshman year. And yeah, sophomore year, it was mainly like, oh, here's Maya. This is like how you do all the things. A ball bounce was one of the projects. Also, there was a lighting project. You do like a lot of lighting and the basics. So this is the fundamentals of Maya sophomore year. Junior year was honing in on like, okay, you know, here's some animation exercises, storyboarding. We did storyboarding, I think sophomore, junior, and a little bit of senior year, but yeah, it was really cool that they, junior year was more of like, what do you like to do? And it was exploring what you kind of wanted as a career. And then second semester was pre-pro, the pre-production of your thesis film. So you had to come in with ideas and pitch it to the faculty and students and, you know, do storyboards of that film. So Sam and I actually did we did a version of Desk Buddies, and then we did a different story called Sweeper Woman or something. It's like a superhero thing, and that we were like, let's not do that.
How did you get teamed up with Sam? Because we've spoken to other Ringling alumni, and they do individual films.
I think some people just go, you know, do it on their own just because they have a vision and they want it a little simplified. But when you do two people, like have two people in a group at Ringling, you have to have more than like one or two characters. Sam and I, we were in a biz dev class together. I told her about a pitch I did in a storyboarding class about dust buddies or dust bunnies. I think it was just dust bunnies. And yeah, we kind of pursued that and just kept like tightening it, like the story itself.
Is there anything that you would do differently if you were to redo dust buddies besides the fur thing, I guess?
I think if I were to go back, it would definitely be the summer beforehand. Beth, you need to explore the fur, figure that out, and not stress about it during the year. Because that was pretty stressful, like trying to work in the labs and figure out, okay, here's the fur system. And Sam actually modeled the maid, and I did the dust buddies, bunnies, and like figured out like how their eyes would move. And like the hardest part was the eye folding over and blinking, because it's like an M&M shape. Yeah. So there was some weird Maya trickery in there, and so
is there any plans for a sequel or a pitch to DreamWorks, because the film holds up, right?
I was wondering that, like, is that even a possibility? I mean, that'd be very, very fun. I saw a comment online that somebody's like, why don't you do a therapy session with the maid? And I told Sam about that the other day. I'm like, we should do a therapy session. Then he's all like curled up, and then have like a dust bunny come into frame, and then she freaks out. But I don't know. We'll see. We'll see about a sequel. I don't know.
Yeah, you can have your own channel on YouTube.
The main characters are Fuzz and Lint, we called them. So we'll have to see if there's the adventures of Fuzz and Lint.
What was the inspiration behind the characters? Like you said, Hot Fuzz, right, was one of the inspirations.
Yeah. Actually, the story came about, it's kind of weird. My family was visiting, and maybe I didn't clean my room, and there were some dust bunnies underneath my bed, and they like rolled out. And my brother was like, oh my God, what the hell, they're alive. I'm like, oh my God, they're alive? They're alive. I'm going to make a film about it. Like, it kind of like, I was trying to find ideas anywhere, because during our storyboarding class, you just had to pitch anything and everything. And like, okay, dust bunnies are alive. Who is their enemy? Okay, a maid. And then it kind of like really tightened after that. Like once Sam and I started talking, that's kind of how that came about. But yeah, it was kind of a weird thing where my brother was freaked out by a dust bunny, so.
There's a short film that we featured from an animation school in Denmark. It's kind of a very similar concept, except theirs is a little more graphic, because you use the vacuum cleaner as the weapon against the dust bunnies. They're using an old lady who's gardening to go against the slugs. So the slugs become alive, and they're the military. And they're being protected by this old lady who's meant to look like this, like, you know, massive enemy who's murdering them with, like, these weapons of mass destruction. When they zoom out, it's really just a lawnmower going, like, really slow.
That's awesome. The juxtaposition of that.
I'm going to share my screen so we can watch Slug Invasion, just like the first 2 minutes.
It's so quiet.
Too quiet, and I don't like it. It's as if... What the foxtrot was that?
Sarge, what the hell is happening?
Did someone just die without my permission? Oh, son of a bitch! Soldiers, take cover!
The blood.
There we go.
Yeah,
it gets a little more graphic and more graphic, but this is a student film as well.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
How many people worked on that? Was
it? It was a group project with 5 students.
Wow, it's 6 minutes long.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love how they can add blood. Just go all out with
Not North America, right? So.
Yeah, I don't know if Ringling would have.
That. We are gonna come back for the next video, and we're gonna go and do a reaction to Dust Buddies, of course, by the animator and director of the film. I have one more question, I guess. The biggest advice to people out there who want to get into this industry, what would that be?
For me, I started at a small studio, and I think working your way up, don't just think you're gonna get into the big studio, the one that you put on a pedestal. I'd say it takes a lot of hard work and building of your reel to achieve that. Don't lose hope, I would say. I think hard work and determination will take you very far.
Well said. All right, so I want to thank Elizabeth Tomashek for joining me and sharing her insight into the industry. I hope you guys learned something. Join us in the next video for the reaction of Dust Buddies. We're going to read some of the comments, and we're going to see if Elizabeth gets a kick out of it. To connect with Elizabeth, find her on Behance or LinkedIn. Do you have a website of your own?
No, but I usually post Instagram stuff.
What's your Instagram?
Eat.sleep.scribble.
If you guys have any questions for Elizabeth or about the industry specifically, leave them in the comments below. As always, make sure you click like, share, and subscribe, and click that bell to get notified of new and upcoming films and interviews. So until next time, my name is Marcin, and we'll see you on the next one.
Thank you so much.